Well, we live in times of great change, turbulence, and sudden and sharp changes in the situation. We saw this only recently in the last few days with the astonishing election results in Iran, where the reformers, despite all the obstacles, won all of the seats in Tehran, a heavy blow for the conservatives. In Ireland, where the Fine Gael Labour coalition was heavily defeated and there was a clear shift, sharp shift to the left. Prior to that, in Spain, we had the amazing result of the election with the rise of Podemos, which is a left formation which came from nowhere virtually, and which now almost overtook the Socialist Party in these elections. And 3 months later, by the way, there's still no government in Spain. Now, all these elements indicate something. It shows the beginnings of a profound change in consciousness, which is evident not in one country or in two. If that were the case, you could dismiss it as an accident, but a general phenomenon. Prior to that, we had the political earthquake. That's what the press described it as. Political earthquake in Scotland, with the rapid rise of the SNP and the demise of the Labour Party. In England and Wales, you have the rise of Corbyn, which again is had a profound effect on politics in this country. But now the most interesting phenomenon, perhaps, is what we observe the other side of the Atlantic, in the United States of America, the wealthiest country in the world, the most powerful capitalist country in the world, and a country in which most people in Europe are considered to be beyond the pale as far as the left wing was concerned, as far as socialism was concerned. For generations now, for as long as anyone can remember, politics in the United States has been dominated by two parties, the Democrats and the Republicans. Two bourgeois parties. These were the, and still are, of course, the columns upon which, the solid pillars upon which American capitalism and American imperialism rests. It was very well put, actually, by a writer that I'm particularly fond of. I think he died, unfortunately, not long ago. I personally regard as the greatest of modern American writers, Gore Vidal, who wrote the following about American democracy. He said, "Our republic, the United States, our republic has got one party, the property party, with two right wings," by which, of course, he meant precisely the Democrats and Republicans. In consequence of this, actually, American politics up until recently, I must confess, was rather boring. Yes, even a journalist in the Evening Standard in London made the comment that American politics were always boring. Now, suddenly, they've become interesting. Yes, suddenly they've become interesting because there are clear indications of a profound change both in the camp of the Republicans and in the camp of the Democrats. Most of the commenters have centered their interest in the phenomenon of Trump, Donald Trump, this multi-billionaire, loud-mouthed maverick, who seems to be on course. I think it's entirely possible. They don't seem to be able to stop him now. He seems to be on course, incredibly, to becoming, we don't know whether it will be allowed to happen, but at the moment it seems to be the case, that Trump is leading the field for the Republicans. Now, this man, as I said, is himself a capitalist. He's a very rich man. He's a multi-millionaire. He's a complete reactionary. There's no question about that. Yeah, and yet, in a skillful demagogic fashion, he's quite an effective demagogue in the way that he speaks. He succeeded in posing as an enemy of the establishment. Of course, he is not. He's part of the establishment. But he speaks in such a way, denouncing the establishment, denouncing the old leaders, and so on and so forth, demanding a change, which undoubtedly has struck a chord in many Americans. This is a fact. And therefore, of course, Trump has acquired a certain popularity, despite the, as I say, the reactionary nature of his views. On the other end of the scale, you have the phenomenon in the Democratic Party, you have the phenomenon of Bernie Sanders. Now, this is interesting. You see, I referred to sudden and sharp changes. Well, what sharper change could you expect, or could you point out, than what's occurred in relation to Sanders? Look, just over 12 months ago, practically nobody in America had heard of Bernie Sanders. Completely unknown individual, a 74-year-old man, white man. Nobody had ever heard of this man, except for the experts in political science. On the other hand, Hillary Clinton, the representative of the Clinton clan, or the Clinton gang, I prefer to call them, was known to everybody. And just 12 months ago, she was leading the field. She had a majority of 52 points over Bernie Sanders. Yes, but now things have changed in a way that nobody could have foreseen, myself included. Nobody could have seen this phenomenon. That now, particularly since the primary in New Hampshire recently, Bernie Sanders is now being taken seriously by the media, by the press, and so on and so forth. He definitely is being taken seriously. He narrowly lost in Iowa. That was the first primary, although I'm not convinced that he did lose. I think it was probably a rigged result. But in any case, Clinton only won in Iowa by the skin of her teeth. Then we have the earthquake of New Hampshire, where he won by a huge margin, which indicates something. What's the reason for this? Then we have, of course, he had a slight setback in South Carolina, but that was expected. But on Super Tuesday, he again won four seats. Clinton won seven, it's true. But nevertheless, that was quite, including places in Colorado, Vermont, which of course is his own seat, Minnesota, and so on. And therefore, we have to explain this phenomenon. How does one explain this success, astonishing success, of Bernie Sanders? It is astonishing. I say a 74-year-old white man of, one has to say, to be a little bit uncanny, somewhat of a somewhat eccentric appearance, and yet he's attracted mass meetings, even in a place like Texas. I note meetings of 10,000, 8,000, and so on, in what was generally considered a conservative area, George W. Bush country. Huge audience all over America. He's attracted huge audience. And for what reason? Well, the reason is the message that he's putting across. Bernie Sanders openly describes himself as a socialist. Now, it's perfectly true, as the Marxists soon pointed out, that his kind, what he describes as socialism is not what we would describe as socialism. It's really a kind of reformism. He refers to Scandinavia as his the Scandinavian model. He refers to Franklin D. Roosevelt as his model, and so on. Yes, so this is not Marxist socialism. No, that's true. But nevertheless, you see, that's all very well. It's all very well, and it's easy to make criticisms of aspects of his policy program and so on. That's true. Yes, but isn't it astonishing that after generations of anti-socialist propaganda in America, an absolutely colossal propaganda machine to cultivate a fear of socialism in people's mind, that Sanders' socialist message strikes a chord in the minds of millions of people, as a matter of fact. I mean, there have been opinion polls, astounding opinion polls, that 69% of young people under the age of 30 would be prepared to vote for Sanders, would be prepared to vote for a socialist candidate. Whereas the older people, as you might expect, people over 65 years of age, the percentage is only 34%. By the way, these figures are before Sanders started his campaign. I think they're from last year. But you see, even that figure is astonishing if you come to think about it. After generations of the most vicious anti-socialist propaganda, even the older generation, people above 65 years of age, 34% would be prepared to vote for a socialist candidate. This is astonishing, if you come to think about it. It represents a most astonishing turnabout in American politics, in the American psyche, in the American psychology, if you like. Now, the question that must be asked is, why? How can one explain this? And the fact is that the bourgeois commentators, the so-called experts, are at a loss to explain this. How does it come? They ask themselves, how does it come about that this elderly gentleman, this white man, attracts a mass of young people? And they themselves are compelled to answer, this was in the Financial Times recently, they answer that it's not, these people support Sanders not in spite of his socialist message, but precisely thanks to his socialist because of his socialist message. Here's a man that constantly denounces, he denounces in quite sharp languages. He rages against Wall Street, against the bankers, against the rich, against inequality. And this is the kind of message people want to hear. Hardly surprising, since the year 2008, since the crisis, of course, millions of American citizens have been badly affected by the crisis. They feel poorer, they are poorer, whereas the fat cats in Wall Street, who really dominate American politics to this day, of course, grow richer by the day. And this creates a crying sense of injustice. The so-called American dream, really speaking, is finished. It's become an American nightmare now for millions of people. And therefore, the message that Sanders is putting, a radical message which he's putting across, an anti-capitalist message, if you like, strikes a chord, resonates in the consciousness of people. And that, of course, itself reflects an important change in the situation. Now, as a result of this, there's quite a huge, I don't know how to describe it, maybe not a movement as yet, because it doesn't seem to be really organized, but certainly there is this groundswell of support for Sanders involving a large number, particularly of young people, of activists. Sanders, for example, has raised a lot of money. Now, here's an important point, and it's not an accident that when he speaks, the part of his speech which gets the most applause, the most enthusiastic response, is where he denounces the fact that Clinton, Hillary Clinton, and people like Hillary Clinton are in the pockets of big business. They're financed by the billionaires, and they get a large donations from the rich. Hillary Clinton was put on the spot in New Hampshire on this very issue, or I think it was in Iowa, even before that. And she was compelled to refer to it, and she said, well, it's true that I get this money, but let nobody say that it dictates my conduct or my policies. To which I answer, really? You know, there's an old English proverb, he who pays the piper calls the tune. And there's no question of who pays these pipers, and also I would add, there's no question whatsoever who will call the tune. And that goes for all of them, except for Sanders. You see, American democracy, one can refer to this, it's supposed to be a democracy. What kind of a democracy is it? Well, in the United States at the present time, in order to be a president, you've got to be a billionaire. Oh, yes. In order to be the president, you've either got to be a billionaire yourself or else have the support of several multi-billionaires. That's the facts of the case. So what kind of a democracy is that? It's a democracy, let's be clear about this, it's a democracy of the 1%, which excludes the 99%. It is, to call a spade a shovel, it is government of the rich, by the rich, and for the rich. And people realize this, you know, as Abraham Lincoln used to say, you can fool some of the people all of the time. And you can fool all the people, some of them, but you can't fool all the people all the time. And people are beginning to understand. what is taking place, this scandalous situation, which Sanders is opposed to, he's sharply criticised, he's denounced. And that's precisely what people like him for. You know, all this fuss, well look, he's badly dressed. They use all kinds of arguments against him. Look, he's got a bad dress sense. Well, maybe so. Maybe so, undoubtedly that's the case. He's a man, frankly, that doesn't get a damn about his personal appearance. It's the impression I've got. Whereas, of course, Hillary Clinton is immaculately turned out, is she not? You know, immaculately, not a hair out of place, you know, probably the best perfume. I didn't get that closer to find out. But nevertheless, one assumes this, you know. Immaculately manicured. Her speeches also are immaculately manicured. And I'll tell you what, people are fed up to hear with carefully manicured politicians speaking carefully manicured speeches. No. I mean, that's partly the explanation of Trump's popularity. He speaks that he's cultivated a kind of plebeian way of speaking, which is different from the other clowns that are standing, which speak in terms of platitudes. People like this. It's what people are looking for. People are looking for something different. People are looking for a change. Now, of course, the $64,000 question is, will that change come? Well, you see, the first thing we have to point out is that Bernie Sanders, undoubtedly a sincere man and so on, we don't doubt this, and we would agree with many of the things that he's putting forward, many of them, like minimum wage and other progressive things that he stands for. Yes, but he's standing on a ticket of the Democratic Party. Now here's the rub, here's the problem. The Democratic Party, of course, is not a socialist party, never has been, never will be. It is a bourgeois capitalist party, it's a party of the rich, right? And therefore, I think it highly unlikely that they will allow Bernie Sanders to proceed. They've got 1,000 means of blocking him, this monstrous, corrupt, anti-democratic party machine. He can be stopped even before it gets to the final election, which I think is in July, if I'm not mistaken. But even there, they've got this so-called system of super-delegates who can, of course, outweigh the votes of millions of ordinary American citizens. So it's not likely that he would be prepared, be able to start. And the question that arises is this. If, as is most likely in my opinion, Sanders is ultimately blocked by the party machine, how will he react? That's the decisive question. So far he has said that if he doesn't get the nomination, then he pledges himself to support Hillary Clinton or any one of the other candidates that the party might choose. Now that would be a fatal mistake. That'd be absolutely, if that were to be the case, then I think that the Sanders movement, unfortunately, would eventually disintegrate, because people, I think, would be disgusted and disappointed at such a thing as that. But, you know, life, it's full of surprises, you know. Lenin once said that history knows all kinds of peculiar transformations. Now let me make my own position clear. We stand, and our American comrades of the will have always stood correctly, for the creation of an American party of labor, a party of the working class. Yes, but you see, we always thought that would come from the unions. However, at least to date, may change of course, but to date, the American trade union leaders are completely opposed to any such thing. They're not interested in the setting up of a Labour Party. They would be terrified at such a development, and they are clinging firmly, clinging for their lives to the shirt tails of the Democratic Party. And personally, I don't see much chance of that changing in the short run. Is it not possible that such a party, a third party, a socialist party or a Labour Party, could emerge in some other way? For example, if Sanders were to say, look, I'm not accepting this, I consider this to be an anti-democratic coup against the will of the people, and therefore I'll have nothing further to do with the Democratic Party. That would be a very desirable outcome. And that itself could be the beginnings, in my opinion, it possibly could be the beginnings of an entirely new development, new turn, and a transformation of American policy, politics. Is this going to happen? Who knows? Your guess is as good as mine. Many things. Tomorrow there's an election, I think, a primary in Michigan, which I think Sanders should win, in my opinion, although the latest poll, I've said, casts some doubts on that, but you can't trust the polls. In any case, because the media now are focusing on the idea that it's all over, it's all finished, Sanders is finished, Hillary Clinton has got it. Well, I don't think so, you know. It's not clear to me. Who knows? There are many primaries ahead, and you can have many surprises. To the degree that Sanders' message is extended and develops and grows, you know, many people can turn towards him. Even in the South, by the way, I noticed in the... It's true that... Clinton won in the South. He's got a traditional base among black voters there. But the young colored people, if you like, Afro-Americans in these states supported Sanders in large numbers. So it's not entirely ruled out. You know, one can have many surprises. This period is full of surprises. I personally don't think that he's going to get the nomination. I think they will block him. And of course, the big question there depends on one person alone, and that's Bernie Sanders. But you see, irrespective of what occurs in relation to the nomination, irrespective of what happens to the primaries and the rest of it, that's really not the point, you know. It isn't the point. The most significant thing, the main thing to see about this question, the Sanders phenomenon, is a fundamental sea change, in my opinion, in the consciousness of millions of ordinary Americans, especially the youth, but not only the youth, who are fed up to the back teeth with this rotten, corrupt, degenerate, unequal, barbarous society and barbarous system, and fervently desire a change. Even the Trump camp, as a matter of fact. Those people, don't you believe that all these people are reactionaries that support Donald Trump? They are similar in many respects to the people who are supporting Sanders. They're ordinary Americans that are sick to death of the old two-party system and these smart Washington politicians, these crooks in sharp suits that misrepresent them in Congress and fervently desire a change. As a matter of fact, many Trump supporters have said if they weren't going to support Trump, they would support Sanders. Not Clinton, but Sanders. Now, here's a major change in the situation, which should and must and will, I believe, fill all of us who stand for socialism, who stand for a fundamental change in society, with enormous pride and hope and confidence in the future of the working class and of socialism, not just in Britain, not just in Europe, but in the United States of America and every other country in the terrestrial globe.